Had a nice break the first part of this week, but I think we're going to pay for it now. So. But I still plan on having church.
Yeah.
I plan on God doing things, and I know he's been doing a lot of stuff for a lot of y'all, me included, and I'm thankful for that tonight. We got a God that loves us and corrects us and fixes us and shows us what we're wrong and makes us better, and I love that, brother. I love that. And I'm thankful for the Villines Trio and all the things that they brought this week and being willing to travel. I told Landon today they're like family now. I just think a lot of them. And Brother Mike, Sister Brenda, we thank you guys for taking time out of your life and helping us out and bringing us the word. So I'm going to ask tonight, I'm going to pick on Brother Gary. I'm going to ask Brother Gary to open us with a word of prayer and ask the Villines to make their way up and sing to us tonight.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I want to thank you tonight, Lord, for this revival, Lord. I want to thank you for the ones you brought in, Lord. And I want to thank you for getting the ones that have got here for the next 2 nights safely. I want to thank you for that, Lord. Lord, I want to thank you for all that you've done here, Lord. And Lord, for the people you brought to me today that I was able to witness to and tell them about you today, Lord. Lord, I want to thank you for that, Lord. That's special to me, Lord. Lord, I want to thank you for giving me time to witness today, Lord. Lord, I want to thank you for this tent, Lord, and I just want to thank you for this ground, Lord. Lord, just to have your will away in this house tonight, Lord. Lord, give Brother Mike what he needs tonight, Lord. Just let him preach it straight and hard. Don't let him hold back. Just let him give it to us all. And we give it to you in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Sing it. Hallelujah, hallelujah. For a moment, the Lord has been so good to us this week. I just feel like God has done some amazing things here, and about to lose my voice. We've been singing for 4 or 5 days in a row, but I'm so thankful. I want to say thank you, Pastor Shane and your wife Alicia, for having us. Y'all are precious people, and this church, y'all are precious to us, and y'all take care of us better, just about as good as anybody else across this country. And I mean that. Very few people treat us like y'all do. And that means a lot when you can come into a place and be taken care of. And that means a lot to us. And I want to say thank you so much. Because not only are you doing that for us, but it's for the Lord. I believe that. I live with a pastor. Emmy and my dad, our daddy is a pastor. So we know what it's like to live in that home and bless your kids' hearts. We know all about that life. My goodness, I could just preach on that. I'm not a preacher, but I could preach on being a preacher's kid. Amen. But praise the Lord. Thank you all so much for having us. One of our favorite places to come to. And I know I'm saying this on behalf of the girls. Thank you so much for the accommodations, the food, and just having us. We love y'all so much. And we're going to sing a few songs tonight, but real quick, we're going to have a choir put together. Y'all are looking at me like a little baby calf looking at a brand new red gate. All you kiddos who know the song Empty Hands, I want you to come right up here and stand right here in front of this pulpit, and let's make a little choir tonight.
Yeah.
Is that all right, Pastor?
Yes, sir. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
These young men sing to us every Sunday
morning. Oh, good. I'm excited about this. Look at this.
Well, hang on, we're missing some.
All right. Come on up, guys. Any of the rest of you kiddos who want to come up, you can come up with us too. We'd love to have you.
Good looking choir, brother.
I think it looks good too. Now, y'all better keep these kids singing when we leave. I mean that. All right, are we ready? Are y'all ready to sing Empty Hands? Now, I want y'all to sing loud. I'm going to put on my teacher voice. Y'all sing loud now. All right? Sing for the Lord.
Yeah.
professional singers I've seen too. Y'all are blessed. Y'all are blessed around here. Thank you guys for coming and singing with us. That just made my day. Praise the Lord. We're going to do just another song or two, and then we're excited to hear Brother Hutsell bring a word. Wasn't that fine preaching last night?
Amen.
Now, that was old-time Holy Ghost preaching.
Yes.
I mean, holy roller preaching. I like it. The kind that gets, my daddy used to say, the kind that gets right down where you're living. Make a Christian slide down their pew. I like that kind of preaching. It keeps us in check. We need it.
Amen.
Draw the sinner to the altar and make the Christian freshen up a little bit. It's good for us. It's good for us. And I'm thankful, Brother Hutsell, for you and your wife and what y'all stand for. It means a lot in this day and time. And I want to sing a song about that, because the world is changing. And while the world is growing darker, the church should be getting brighter.
Amen.
And I'm so thankful tonight that that old Bible, that old King James Version Bible,
Amen.
It hasn't changed.
Amen.
It hasn't changed. The world is changing, but the Word of God remains the same.
Amen.
I want to sing this song. Some things never change. I'm not worried in my soul where this whole world may go, what I see on the news today. I'm not weeping with regret. I've chosen not to fret about this ever-changing world and its ways. But I'll put my attention on that heavenly intervention. It's brought me out of darkness into the light. It's not mind over matter. It's more than worthless chatter. It's all about the blood of Jesus Christ. And I still have the Bible. This modern day, old saints are still praying, and old sinners who are straying are receiving God's saving grace. It's the old ragged cross that's still saving the lost. Thank God, some things never change. I'm thankful. Across this nation and proven, oh, that He is still the same today. There's not a different approach. It remains as God wrote, and it can't be explained away. Now they say that my convictions are just religious addictions, and it all must be rearranged. Oh, but I've been on my knees, and God reassures the Bible, a guide to survival. It's brought me to this place. Hallelujah. And I still believe in Christian. Old time convictions are the answer for this modern day. Old saints are still praying, and old sinners who are straying are receiving God's saving grace. It's the old rugged cross. Still praying, and old sinners who are straying, they're receiving God's saving grace.
It's the old rugged cross that's still saving the lost. Saving the lost, thank God. Some things never change.
Some things never change.
Some things never change.
This world that's always changing,
yeah.
One thing remains the same, and that's the Word of God.
Yes.
The Bible says that heaven and earth would pass away, but He said, my Word will never pass away. way. I'm thankful tonight we can stand on His word and that it's written in stone. Praise the Lord. Preacher, it's going to be good up here tonight. I just feel it. Praise the Lord. We're going to do just one more song. And I just want to say again, I may not get the opportunity, but thank you so much for having us again. We love y'all so much. And I'll tell you, I'm looking for the rapture.
Yeah.
I'm looking for the rapture.
Yeah.
And so if before the next time we get to come back, the Lord has come, I want to see you up there.
Amen.
I really believe that's how close we are.
Yes,
y'all pray for us. We've got a lot of traveling to do the rest of this year. We're next month we're going into Texas and Florida and Mississippi. So y'all pray for us as we minister. We love y'all so much. I want Hannah to come and sing a song off our new album, Resurrection Morn.
Good in here tonight, amen.
Amen.
Amen. how God has answered my prayer. I asked him to start sending the breeze when it got right tonight, and it's got right. Can you feel it?
Amen.
God is going to take care of us this evening. I appreciate it. Can I ask you just to be seated for a moment? I want to take an opportunity, if I may, to echo what Brother Landon has already said. My wife and I want you to know we're deeply grateful for your love and your support of us, your help to us. We love your fellowship. We love coming to this church. We love your pastor and his wife and their family, and such a wonderful fellowship that you have that God's given you. I love your happiness, the joy that I can see that you have in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we just want to express what he did. Thank you for the room that you provided us. Thank you for the lunch today. Thank you for my 1611 shirt. I've got people that I'm guaranteed when I wear that at Oak Lane, because we're a strong King James Bible church, they're going to want to make those t-shirts. And y'all don't have a copyright on it, do you?
No. Nope.
All right. But praise the Lord for your kindness and your goodness to us. We thank you for that. And the gift basket that you brought us. You can tell Brenda and I really don't need those things, and we're both diabetics, and we have a hard time turning that stuff down. It is so good. But thank you so much for all of it. I appreciate God's people all over this country that has been so kind to us and so good to us. And you're among that family. And I'm glad I'm going to get to go to heaven with you.
Amen.
We're going to spend eternity together. Let me take just a minute before I preach to you tonight to share with you just a little bit about how we got started in Kenya, Africa. There was a preacher by the name of John Colonzo that had started watching the services that I ministered in when I pastored in Broken Arrow, Oklahoma. We live streamed from that church, and he watched it for 2 or 3 years. And then one day he called me in my office there with a conference call with about 5 different preachers from his churches. They're called Christian Churches International. And when you think of Christian churches, naturally, and when I heard that phrase, I associated that with Christian churches here in America. But it was not until I went there that I learned that they have no common ground whatsoever to the Christian churches here. They just believe they're born-again Christians. They're the church, the body of Christ. And the reason they use the term international is because they want ministries from everywhere that's true ministries to come and minister unto them. They believe strongly in the King James Bible, and their doctrines are as clean and pure as I've ever found. Well, he invited me to come to Kenya, and I had no desire. I didn't tell him that, but there was really no desire in my heart or anything that I felt about that. But he called me twice, and the second time he called me, I felt more of a burden about it than I'd ever felt. So my wife and I prayed this prayer, and we prayed this on New Year's Day, 2013. And that was in our living room. We knelt beside our sofa, and I told her, I said, Brenda, if God wants us to go to Kenya, Africa, he'll have to send us a man from Kenya to America to tell us that's what he wants to do. And the reason that I put such a prayer before God is because prior to that, I was reading in my devotions, Jeremiah 33:3, when he said, call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not.
Amen.
And my prayer wasn't about Kenya. My prayer is, God, I want you to show me something that only you can do. And so we prayed, God, if you want us to go to Kenya, send a man from Kenya to America. Well, this man named Tobias Olo felt compelled in his heart to go down and see what it would be or what he would have to do to get a visa to leave the country, a passport, and such as that. And he found out it was going to cost him $185. Now, to you and I, $185 to me is a lot of money. But to an African, that's a great amount of money, seeing that many of them don't earn but $300 a month. And so he had no money, but when he left the customs office and got home, there was a check in the mail from a guy in Ohio that had sent him the check, and in there a note that said, I don't know why, but God told me to send you $185. And he took that check and went back to customs the next day and filed his paperwork. And he got a visa, and they started the process of getting him the paperwork that he needed to come to America.
And then God impressed him that he was going to leave America to go meet a man, or leave Africa to come to America to meet a man. And he prayed this prayer when he sat down on the airplane. God, if you will be with me and lead me to the man that I'm supposed to meet, what am I meeting him for? And God told him, the man that you'll meet, you're to tell him to come to America, or to come to Africa from America. And he said, I asked him, how will I know, God? I'm surely going to meet a lot of people. And he said, the Lord told him that the man that he was to tell to come to Africa would be the only preacher that he would meet on this journey, that would book him in several appointments for him to preach at. And when that preacher told him that he had several appointments for him, he'd know that he's met the man. So he came to America, and he arrived at a camp meeting Lonnie Burks was holding there at Oak Lane Church, which happened, I believe, in March of 2013. And when he came in the back door and was standing in the back of the church, I was up front talking to another person. And as clearly as I've ever heard God speak to my heart, he said, go meet that man. And when I went, I didn't know what the mindset of people was there. There's areas across our country that there's still a lot of prejudice. And Brother Olo's as black as midnight. And I went to him, and I stuck out my hand, and I said, my name is Mike Hutsell. And he said, my name is Tobias Olo. And he said, may I hug you? And when we embraced as brothers in Christ, the first time in my life I've ever had this experience, never had it since, but it felt as if my heart touched his heart and we were knitted. Amen. It was like our hearts kissed. And I backed up and he looked at me and he said, did you feel what I felt? I said, what did you feel? He said, it felt as if our hearts touched each other.
Amen.
And so I didn't make any comment about it, but I said after service I'd like to eat lunch with you. So we did, and he told me that he was going to ride a bus back to Ohio to a conference, and then he didn't know what he was going to do because he had no place to go. And so I invited him to come back to Tulsa, Oklahoma, and I bought him a bus ticket. And I told him I'd pick him up at the bus station, and he could stay in our home until he went back to Kenya. And so he left, and we left that camp meeting, and when I got home, God began to deal with me to do something that I've never done before. I don't recommend preachers unless I really know them. And when I mean really know them, I've got to know that they're real, they're genuine, and they're living it. Because I want to tell you folks, there's not every preacher crawls in the pulpit that's genuine and living it. And God dealt with me to start scheduling him some appointments. And I scheduled him because he contacted me and told me what day he was coming back in Tulsa. And so I scheduled him every Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, which was seven services that he would have before he went back to Kenya, Africa. I picked him up at the bus station. I bought him a meal, brought him to the house, and put him to bed and let him rest because he hadn't had any rest for several hours. The following morning, I was on my way to Stuart, Oklahoma to preach in an association meeting. I was traveling along, and I said, Preacher Olo, I need to tell you something. If you don't want to do this, it'll be fine. I can change the services. But I felt like God impressed my heart to schedule you some places to go preach while you're here. And I've never heard you, and you better not let me down. And he said, well, what do you mean let me down? He said, before you say another word, he said, you need to stop the car. And tears was bursting out of his eyes, streaming down his face, and I said, stop the car. And he said, yes, please. And I pulled the car to the side of the road, and he said, you're the man that I was sent to America, and you need to listen to me right now. He said, God sent me here to tell you he wants you to come to Africa.
Amen.
Amen. Woo!
And when he said that, my mind went back to the sofa where me and my wife prayed. And I said, God, if you want me to go, send a man. Yes. Now, I know you might sit there and think, I don't know if I believe that or not, and that's your privilege. But when we stand before the Lord, you'll know.
That's right.
And I said, God told you that you was coming to meet me. How did you know that you would find me? He said, I didn't know either, but he said, God told me the only preacher that would schedule me regularly would be the man that I'm to tell. He's to come to Africa. And you just told me that you scheduled me 7 services. And you've got to be the man, because no other preacher's preached me. No one else has given me that opportunity. And he said, I didn't come looking to preach, except that I knew the man that was scheduling me would be the man that I had to tell.
Man.
And so I'm driving on to this meeting quiet. And I'm sure he's wondering why I'm so quiet. And my prayer to God was this: how am I going to go to Kenya? God, you know how poor I am. You know that there's times that me and my wife don't have 2 nickels to rub together. I'm not telling you that for you to be sympathetic with me. I'm just telling you that God's been good to me, and it ain't all about money. I've learned to live with what God's given me. And that day, I preached the sermon. I introduced Brother Olo. He gave a brief testimony. And the moderator of that association got up, and he said, God has laid it on my heart to put an offering basket here on this altar. And if you want to help Brother Hutsell get to Africa, you come and do whatever God lays on your heart. And folks, I took that money home, got on the internet, and what they gave me bought me a ticket to Kenya, Africa. And God will answer your prayers. So I went in 2014, and we spent 21 days there, and we had 67 souls saved during that 21 days. And it was a great experience, because I only took 200 Bibles with me, flying them over on the airplane. And my first experience in Bible distribution was a stage about this size. And I was standing with my arms full, and the folks standing in the back and folks standing down front. There was about 500 people in that tabernacle that day. And when I told them I only had 200 copies of the Word of God, the people in the back started running forward. And the people in front figured out what was happening, and they came running forward, because they knew if the people got there before they did, they might not get a Bible. And they all was like a herd of livestock that was stampeding, and they couldn't get stopped, and they ran on into me, and my arms full, I fell backwards on the stage and landed on my back. And I started laughing. And Preacher Olo got up and rebuked them and said, how terrible that you would treat our guests this way. And I said, Preacher, don't do that. Nobody in America has ever run over me to get a Bible.
Amen.
Amen.
And this is a blessing and a joy to me.
Yeah.
But I'm going to tell you something that happened that day. When I handed that last Bible out, in them little African hands that kept reaching out for a Bible, they never had one. My heart ached so bad that I couldn't even preach. And I said, God, if we ever come back here, you've got to help me with Bibles.
Yes.
And give me enough every time I come that these people can all have a Bible. And I'm here to testify to you tonight that I've been back 4 times. And from 2015 on, I've never had a hand that didn't get a Bible.
Yeah.
God has always provided.
Yes.
And that's because the church is like yours. You send help. Now, when we started, we were buying Bibles for $4.80 shipped over. And since the pandemic, the Bibles have doubled. We're paying over $9 a Bible. But we have found a warehouse there in Kenya that by American Bible Society, that we buy them through there, and the preachers can go there and get them and distribute them. And that's a great help and a blessing. So let me just say thank you for what you've done to help us. And let me just tell you this, that this trip in Kenya, we distributed 1,000 Bibles. We had 5 souls saved in 2 conferences. In one of the conferences, the bishop of that conference called his 34 pastors together after I taught them the doctrines of salvation, what the Bible said. And because the bishop had called me and said, we have a terrible confusion going on in our churches, and it serves most likely to divide us and split us, because a group come in from America that told us, once you get saved, no matter what you do or how you live, you can never be lost. And I just took the Bible and just walked them through it, because this book will answer itself.
Yes.
And on the last day of the conference, when we had finished, the bishop took the pulpit and he said, our 34 pastors have met, and I want to declare unto you that the word of God that the pastor brought us has cleared up the confusion. The issue is settled. We're going to stand by the word of God.
Amen.
And so we feel like that was a great accomplishment. 5 souls was worth it.
Amen.
1,000 Bibles distributed was worth it.
Yes.
And then we had 41 pastors. We're training pastors, because many of them came forward from formal education. And we trained them in four Bible courses, New Testament, Old Testament survey, the life of Christ studies, and New Testament church history. These booklets are bought through ACE, Accelerated Christian Education. And we use that to train those pastors, and it's made a great difference. And we graduated in 2015. We graduated 51 then, or actually 52. My wife took the course with them and graduated with them, and they call her Mother Matriarch now. And she has to be on stage with us when we give them their Bible completion certificate. And this year we graduated 41 more. So we've trained 91 pastors since 2014 to the present day that is preaching the Word of God and has a better understanding of the Bible than they've ever had.
Amen.
When we were there in 2018, at the last day we was there, little children come running in because they heard there was food that was being distributed. And when they came in, there was no more food. And the babies started crying. And I looked around to see where my wife and my son that was with me was at. And they was over to the side of the church weeping and praying. And I walked over there to them. And Brenda looked at me and said, "Did you see the faces of those babies? Walked in here needing something to eat. And there was nothing for them to eat. And all of us adults had something to eat. Had we known those children were coming, we would have not fed ourselves. We'd have fed them." And she said, "Mike, if we ever come back, I don't know how we'll do it." Because she said, "I know how difficult our finances are to come. But not only do we need to give Bibles, but we've got to feed the children."
Amen.
And I said, "Brenda, you just trust God and let Him be your guide." And after we got back home, she testified to that fact. And she said, "I feel God's laid it in my heart." And she said, "My husband gives me some money every week, and I'm going to start a program called Brenda's Bread Basket." And she said, "I'm going to start saving money to feed those little children." And I want to testify to you tonight that God has blessed that ministry in the last 2 years. Just 2 weeks ago, we had a strange family walk up to us and donated $10,000.
Amen.
Now you listen to me. I'm not one of these preachers that's going to take a percent out of that $10,000. 100% of that money will be spent for those children.
Yeah.
Yeah. We do exactly what we say, and we keep records, and I've got a board that I count to every year, and they can look at the records and see what our income has been and what our expenditures has been, and they know what we've done with all the Bible money and what we're doing with all the money that feeds the children. And we inaugurated that ministry there this time, and 450 little children came in. And we asked them if they could feed them a bigger bowl than what they've been getting, because they got small bowls. And this year, when we fed them, they got a great big bowl full of rice, full of vegetable soup, and with a big piece of what they call chapati bread. We would call it flatbread here, fried. And the first little boy that came out of that cabin had that big bowl, and his eyes looked like fireworks going off. And he said to all the kids, he said, "Look at this big bowl of soup." And he was so excited, and he went up to my wife, and he said, "Thank you, thank you, thank you."
Amen.
It's people like yourselves that gives us whatever you give. And we don't beg for money, and I don't go around telling people, "You got to help us, you want." I don't want you to do nothing if God don't ever speak to you. You don't owe us. You don't owe God's ministry anything if He don't speak to you about it. Well, I'll tell you this: if God tells you to buy a Bible, your $9 gift will buy a Bible.
Amen.
If God tells you to feed a child, your $5 bill will feed one child. And you don't do anything unless God tells you. But I promise you, if you do anything, it will go 100% for what we promise you. It will go for.
Amen.
So thank you so much. I could stop right there tonight. I'm blessed just by what I've seen God do since 2014 in Kenya, Africa. Now, in case you don't think that's so, I'll tell you what you do. Next time we go, I'll let you know. You buy you an airplane ticket and go with us and find out for yourself if what anything I've said is the truth. The Kenyan people will tell you themselves that God sent a blessing. They call us a blessing, but I want to tell you the blessing has been ours to see what God has done with them. So God bless you and thank you for letting me share that with you tonight. Turn your Bibles this evening to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 18. And in the chapter, in this chapter tonight, I'm going to read about six verses of this chapter. And share with you a thought that God has laid in my heart. This is not a new message. There's not a preacher on this earth that's going to preach anything new. It amazes me that sometimes preachers want to come into churches and they want to bring some sort of a wow factor. And that's not what God called me to do. All God's called me to do is just preach the Word of God. And to preach it straight and to preach it as it is written in the Bible. Yes, there are occasions that I insert some of my own thoughts in there. But I try to make sure that when I am inserting my thoughts that I have been careful in my studies to be sure that I can prove what thoughts I insert. Because God's going to hold me accountable for how I preach His divine Word. And if I was to mislead somebody and cause them to be turned out of the way, God says that their blood will be on my hands. So that's not my desire tonight. And so there is a message in a house that God would send Jeremiah to. It was not the house of God, but it was a potter's house. And God sent him there for a specific message. And I believe tonight that God has sent me here to this house with the same message tonight for this congregation to receive. If you're Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 1, would you say amen?
Amen.
The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause thee to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again, another vessel, as seemed good to the potter to make it. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter, saith the Lord? Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in mine hand, O house of Israel. May I ask you tonight to substitute, if you would please, O house of Israel, for O house of this church tonight, the body that's here tonight. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I thank you for this service. I thank you for what our heart has felt and what we've already received in blessings through the ministry of music and the message that's in the songs and the melodies, God, that has elevated our heart and allowed us to be seated in heavenly places and to be thinking upon those things that the songs were teaching us. The songs should teach us when we're worshiping. They're to help us learn, God. One of these days, we are going to step inside the gate. And God, we're going to see all of those great saints of God that we love that's already preceded us. And what a joyful day that's going to be, God, when we arrive in your eternal presence. We're not going there because we have been a preacher's kid. We're not going there because we've been baptized or a member of a church. But we're going there because you bought us with your precious blood on Calvary. And you birthed us by the Holy Spirit into the family of God. And you have led us by your Spirit and through your Word. Now tonight, God, I pray that you'll speak into all of our hearts and help us to realize that sometimes in life there's people that think they've messed their lives up so bad, they're so marred, and they thank God that there's no changing anything that's ever happened. The truth is, as I preached last night, God, there's nothing but wickedness and corruption in any of us. Then there's no good thing in our flesh. And had you left us unto ourselves, we'd all perish. But you loved us even while we were yet sinners and sent Jesus to die for us. And through his death and through his resurrection, you have promised that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. God, only you know the true heart of every person in this house tonight. And only you know, God, if they have any spiritual birth in them at all. And if they don't, God, tonight let this be the hour and the moment that they hear the voice of the Son of God calling them and help them to come and get right with you tonight. God, help those that say they're saved, but Father, they're drifted in their heart and they're not in love with you like they should be. reflecting the glory of God. Help them to repent tonight and rededicate their life. And thank you for this loving church and loving pastor and his wife and this family, God, that has been so good to us. And I pray that you'll return them 100-fold. Lord, my prayer is that whatever they ever allow us to come and do and whatever they spend to help us, I pray it'll never cost them. I pray you'll restore them 100-fold. Yes, and bless them, God. And last night, there was just something special, God. I don't know what it is and what it was, but you was dealing with me to kneel on this piece of ground right here and pray because, God, you impressed me that you're going to do something in this church. And I don't know what it is. I'm not a prophet, and I'm not trying to prophesy. But Father, I know when the Holy Ghost impresses me about something, and I believe, God, in what this preacher stands for and what he's trying to do for the glory of God. And I pray that you'll magnify yourself to this city, God, greater than it's ever been known. I know there's other churches here, God, but you can put your hand right here. And I pray you'll do that and that you'll magnify Jesus Christ in a greater way than this city's ever seen. And let there be hundreds added to this church, such as should be saved. And we'll give you the praise and we'll give you the glory. In Jesus' name I ask these favors and blessings. And God's people said,
amen.
Shake somebody's hand before you're seated and thank them for coming tonight. Let me ask you to be seated now and gather your thoughts here for just a moment. Let me ask you to consider a few things that I want to lay on your heart tonight. The prophet Jeremiah was sent to the potter's house for a reason. Can I tell you tonight that those that would know God's mind must observe His appointments? If you think tonight that you're here by your choice and chance, you do have a choice in the matter. But I believe you're here tonight by divine appointment. I believe I'm here by divine appointment. I believe the Villines Trio is here by divine appointment. And wherever God allows me to go, I consider it a divine appointment. And if I would know God's mind, I must observe His appointments and listen. And I must attend where they may hear His words. If you don't ever attend regularly and consistently in the appointments that God has established in the Word of God, you'll not really know the mind of God, nor will you know His great will. The house of God is important, and it's very important that you come here. I'm not saying that tonight because there's anybody that I know of that's not. As a matter of fact, let me just tell you this. It was said to me last night that you can come here Sunday morning and you'll see a good crowd. And you can come here Sunday night and you'll see the same crowd. And you can come here on Wednesday night and you'll see the same crowd.
Amen.
Praise God Almighty for giving you the same crowd that is consistently coming.
Amen.
Because in our society today, Sunday morning churches have good crowds. Sunday night they lose about 50% of their crowd. And Wednesday night they lose another 50% of their crowd. And you cannot expect to know God's mind or God's will if you're not keeping His appointments. But coming to the house of God is just one of those appointments.
Yeah.
It's important for you to understand that another appointment that God wants to keep with you every day is that you come to His Word for a daily feeding and a daily nurturing of the Word of God.
Amen.
Another appointment that God wants you to keep every day is a prayer time.
Amen.
Jesus said, enter into your closet of secret place, close the way from all the world and pray to your Father in secret, and your Father that sees in secret will reward you openly. And there's no greater joy that you can have, Jesus said, than to ask of Him, and He shall give you those things that you ask, that you might rejoice in the blessings of His answered prayers. And God uses similitudes like this potter's house in helping the prophets of old as they put forth a message. The prophet Hosea said in his letter, chapter 12 and verse number 10, I have also spoken, saith the Lord, by prophets, and I have multiplied visions, and I have used similitudes. And similitude is the same word as a parable. And we know the greatest preacher that ever walked on the face of the earth was Jesus Christ himself. Amen. And he used parables. And God did the same thing by the ministry of his prophets. And that was what this is that Jeremiah was doing. He was sent to this potter's house, and he was sent there to see a similitude out of which would come a message that God would give him to deliver unto his people. And so Jeremiah rose and he went down. Now let me tell you something tonight. If God is dealing with our hearts to go do something, we need to get up and go do it.
Amen.
If God is telling you to just stand up in the house of God, you say, I don't know why he wants me to stand, but God just put it in my heart to stand. Well, stand up if that's what God tells you to do. If he impresses your heart to lift your hands in worship of him, worship him and lift your hands. You say, well, what will people think of me? You're too focused on people and not focused enough on God. He is worthy tonight of my hands being raised. I'm his little child. I'm his little kid tonight. Not one time did my little children, nor do my little grandchildren, nor any child in the church I pastor walk up to me and raise their hands. But what I will stoop down and lean into them, and if they'll let me, I pick them up and I try to make sure that I hold them appropriately, no matter whether they be a boy or a girl. God's little children has got their hands up. God will lean into you and lean down to you. And if you'll let him, he'll pick you up and he'll bless you. I didn't come to the house of God to just go through a ritual. I didn't come to the house of God just to do some special things. I come here for God to do something for me and to lift me and encourage me so I can go out there and live my life. And so God wants us to pay attention in the house of the Lord. Jeremiah rose and he came to the potter's house by divine direction. And you need to understand tonight that you have been saved by the grace of God.
Amen.
And you've been led by the Holy Spirit of God. And everything that God is directing in your life is a divine direction. And you need to follow that divine direction. Because God will always place you to hear his word. And that isn't always in going to church. There's been times in my life that God's told me where to go. And certain people to go see or go visit. Sometimes I've went down to a hospital to visit somebody. And while I was there, it wasn't the patient that was there that I went to see that I knew. But it was somebody else standing in the room who had dropped by to visit. And the patient introduced me. And we got to talking, and I got to plant a seed of the word of God. And I've seen the power of God move on people. We need to learn to be obedient to God, because God will make you some divine appointments out here in the world so that you can harvest fruit for God. And your church can grow as a result. God has two things in mind, two great truths in mind that Jeremiah has got to go preach after he hears God's message at the potter's house. The first thing that has to be that Jeremiah has to preach is that God has an incontestable authority. And we're living in an age where authority is being challenged on every hand. They're challenging the authority of the authenticity of whether this is really God's word.
Yeah.
And they're trying to remove words from it and things from it.
Amen.
I said this to a fellow one time that come to me with a different version. He said, prove to me this ain't the word of God. And so I took him to a few scriptures and showed him that they have removed the blood from most of the other translations.
Yep.
And when you take blood out of a human body, what's going to happen to that human body if you drain it of its blood?
Right.
You're going to die.
Right.
And the lifeline of the Bible is the blood that flows from the early Old Testament all the way through the New Testament. In fact, God said, the blood I've given to you as an atonement for your souls. And he said, when I see the blood, I pass over you. You're not cleansed except it's by the blood of Jesus Christ. Even our modern day churches don't like to sing the old hymns, washed in the blood and power in the blood. But I want you to know tonight, the blood of Jesus Christ is what cleanses you from your sin. And without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. And when you don't have a Bible that talks about the blood, you don't have the Word of God.
Amen.
Actually, there's been more than 40,000 words removed from other translations.
Yep.
But I said to this fellow, would you get on an airplane if the pilot said we're going to cross the ocean? This plane has only, it has 22,000 vital parts missing. But come aboard, we'll fly it together and see if we make it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can get on if you want to, but I ain't going with you.
Yeah.
When I get on that plane crossing that ocean, I want that plane to be mechanically sound.
That's right.
With every part working and functioning. And if it goes down, so be it. But at least if it goes down with all of its parts, I'll feel better about dying knowing it had all of its parts. And brothers and sisters, when I come to die, I want to know I've got all the parts to die with.
Yeah.
And so Jeremiah says, or had to go preach to them, that God has incontestable authority. That means it's undisputable. You can't dispute God's authority. And the second thing was his irresistible ability. And why do you say that, preacher? Well, I want you to look, if you will, at this chapter for just a moment and notice something in verse number 4. The vessel that Jeremiah goes and sees this potter working on the wheel, he sees and notices that the clay becomes marred in the hand of the potter. And when he sees that it becomes marred in the hand of the potter in verse number 6, here's where you see the incontestable authority and the irresistible ability of God to form and fashion whatever He chooses in His own likeness and in His own way. Because from verse 7 through verse number 10, He is talking about the nations and the kingdoms. Look, if you will, at verse 7. At what instance I speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom to pluck it up and to pull down and to destroy it, if that nation against whom I have pronounced turn from their evil, I will repent, saith the Lord, of the evil that I thought to do unto them. And at what instant I speak concerning a nation and a kingdom to build it and to plant it, if it do evil in my sight that it obey not my voice, then I will repent of the good wherewith I said I would benefit them. So the incontestable authority of God and the irresistible power and ability of God is this. That if He has said, I'm taking that nation down, if that nation would change its mind, change its wicked ways, and repent of their sins, God will change His mind and repent, and God will show that nation mercy.
Yeah.
And if there's ever been a time that a nation needs the mercy of God,
amen,
the United States of America needs it in this hour we're living in. You say, well, that's a message that's only a few getting it. But you need to understand something. The few that get it can spread it.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Did you notice how fast COVID spread?
Yeah.
And I want to tell you right now, there ain't nothing that'll spread faster by the power of God than the gospel people really portray it right.
Yeah.
Amen. But God also said, if a nation whom I have said I would bless and build them up, if that nation turns and does evil, I will repent of the good that I said I would do to them, and I will destroy them. That's the authority God has.
Right.
And I don't have the right to dispute Him, but we got a generation that is pure in their own eyes, and the Bible talks about it.
Yeah.
Pure in their own eyes. How did you get your purity? Where did your purity come from? You think you got it because you got a great intellect? You think you got it because you have a great name? You think you got it if you have a big bank account? Where did you get such an idea that we have any right to dispute God or to call God into question?
Yeah.
God can do with us as He pleases to do with us.
Amen.
And I want you to look up here tonight. You're looking at a man that would have went to hell if God had not had mercy upon my soul.
Amen.
And I'm looking at some people that'll go to hell if God don't have some mercy on your soul.
That's right.
And I'm going to tell you something. In this hour that we're living, authority is being disputed in the schoolhouse.
Yes.
It is being disputed in the church house.
Amen.
It's being disputed in your and my house. Children's rising up and talking to their moms and dads in ways. And I'll promise you, if I'd have tried that and some of the older folks here tried that, there would have been a timeout, all right.
Yeah.
Dad would have walked with me to the tree that he wanted me to take time out and cut a limb.
Yeah.
And then Dad would say, hand me the limb and get a hold of something because you're going to need it.
Yeah.
And somebody said, well, I'd report your dad to DHS. He'd have whipped them too. See, the problem is we won't stand for nothing. And when you won't stand for nothing, you'll fall for anything. I'm not talking about abusing children. And I'm not talking about doing things that hadn't ought to be done to kids. But I am telling you this. I'm not saying that spanking is the only way you can discipline them. There's other methods you ought to try to use. But when you've exhausted your methods and it's not working, cut you a switch and find out if it won't work.
Amen.
You know why? Because God said if you beat them with a rod, you will not destroy them.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, you'll save their soul from hell.
That's right.
Amen.
But we don't like that in this generation.
Yep.
Because we're a generation that thinks we're pure in our own eyes, but God said you're not washed from your filthiness.
Yep.
And so Jeremiah went down by divine direction and saw this work being wrought on the wheel, and he saw it become marred in the potter's hands. What was the potter to do at this point? He has the incontestable authority as well as the irresistible ability as the one with the power over that clay. He can take that lump off of there and he can throw it in the trash. But when you read the text in verse number 6, it says he made it again.
Okay.
The potter made it again. And the message is clear tonight. I don't know who I'm talking to or what your past has ever been. Every one of us in this room tonight have a past.
Yep.
And every one of us in this room may have a past that we don't even like to talk about. And if you're saved, you hadn't ought to talk about it.
Yep.
But I don't care how deep in sin you've gone. And I don't care how wicked you've lived. And I don't care how unrighteous you've been. You're looking at a God in heaven tonight who said His hand is not short that He cannot save. And His ear is not heavy that He cannot hear. And there's not anything in your life that He can take it much and do it again and make a new vessel out of you and one that honors Him.
Amen.
Right, amen.
I want to give you the lyrics of a song. I want you to listen to its words. These are some tremendous words. Empty and broken, I came back to Him. A vessel unworthy, so scarred with sin. But He did not despair. He started over again. I bless the day He didn't throw the clay away.
Amen.
He is the potter and I am the clay. Molded in His image, He wants me to stay. When I stumble and I fall and my vessel breaks, He just picks up the pieces. He didn't throw the clay away.
Amen.
Over and over, He molds me and makes me. Into His likeness, He fashions the clay. A vessel of honor I am today, all because Jesus did not throw the clay away.
Amen.
He's talking about you and I.
Yeah.
Right. Amen.
And Jeremiah, the nation of Israel, had sinned so much that they looked like a nation that ought to be destroyed and cast away. They become marred. But God is the potter. And when Jeremiah went there by divine direction, he also discovered defilement there. In this clay, the potter didn't even know that it was there. In fact, if you study the Eastern culture, they're very careful where they go and select their mud or their clay that they're going to make their pottery out of, and they get it in their hands and they squeeze it and they press it a lot to try to see what's in there, what kind of impurities are in there. But they're smart enough to know that once they put it on the wheel and they begin the spinning process, and the potter puts special things on his hands like the water, and he reaches over to the clay and he begins to fashion it and mold it and to make it what he wants. It's then there that the potter knows and understands he's going to find something perhaps that he's going to have to do something with it and do it over again. He doesn't take it off of the wheel and throw it aside. If it becomes marred, he'll do something else with it and make it still a vessel to the honor of the vessel he's making.
Yeah.
Amen.
And God did the same for you and I.
Yeah.
I've seen people that were horrible drug addicts that God didn't wipe them off of the vessel or off of the potter's wheel. But instead what God did was make them again.
Yeah.
I had a brother that was a 25-year alcoholic. He drank every day till he was so out of his mind. He had no desire to visit with anybody. He had no desire to have any happiness in life. And I'd started preaching, and I was going over to the church of your daddy, Pastor Gary, Ernie Holiday, Niangua, Missouri. But Ernie was gracious enough to give me my first revival appointment. He told some of his church, and Brother Ernie told me this later, now, I don't know, this young fellow's just started preaching. He may preach 5 minutes, he may not even preach 5 minutes. But you have songs ready, and he said, some of you other preachers that's come to the meeting, you be ready. But I shocked him. I've never been a 5 minute preacher. And that night, my dad went by and said to my brother, would you do one thing for me if you do nothing else? And he said, what's that, Dad? He said, your brother started preaching. He's preaching his first revival. Would you slip in on him tonight and listen to him? I didn't see him come in. I didn't see him the entire time I was preaching. But I was preaching that night about God can make your life brand new again. In fact, what I was emphasizing is, have you ever said, if I could start life over, I'd do it different? Well, I got some good news for you. You can start life over. Jesus will start it.
Yep.
And people began to pour into the altar, and I was on this side of the church praying with a fella when a man leaned over my back and his hot tears dropped on my back, and I felt him, and he whispered to me, and he said, you might want to come to the other side. There's someone awaiting you. And I rose up and walked over there, and there was my 25-year alcoholic brother. He smelt and reeked with alcohol. And I knelt beside him and called him by his first name. And I said, I'm so thankful you're here. I didn't even know you was here. And he said, I'm here because I'm at the end of my road. And he said, if God don't do something for me tonight, I'm done. And I said, why don't you call him and see what he'll do?
Right.
And I heard him say, God, if you can save a drunk, here I am, save me.
Yeah.
Whether you believe this or not, the smell of alcohol left him. And he came up a new creature in Christ.
Amen.
And he never returned to alcohol again. And 7 years later, he started preaching the gospel.
Yeah.
And he stayed faithful to Christ until God called him home in December of 2022.
Amen.
And I've sat with him many a time and said to him, what was it that you thought would not happen if God didn't do? He said, I think I would have committed suicide. Because he said, I had no reason to want to live because there was nothing about me that anybody would desire. I couldn't get a job. And my wife was making our living, and I was taking all of our extra money, destroying myself with alcohol. But he said, you remember that song, God Didn't Throw the Clay Away? He said, that's me.
Amen.
God has a divine appointment for you in somebody's life. When you get with them, you're going to see the defilement that is there. But you know what we don't need to do? You don't need to start criticizing them and judging them and telling them what's wrong. They already know what's wrong.
Yes, right.
They already know there's a deep-seated need in their life. And listen, I'll tell you something else they know. They know in reality the preacher hasn't got anything that he can do for them nor the church. But I'm going to tell you, for what we ought to be, people of God, when they come into the house of God, there ought to be some power there from heaven changes everything about those circumstances.
Amen.
And that's what Jeremiah was going to learn in this potter's house. So let me give you the third and final thing tonight. He came by divine appointment or direction and saw the defilement that he discovered in this piece of clay. But the potter showed that he had determined discretion. He made it again. And the potter in heaven has a determined discretion. He will make you again if you'll allow him.
Yeah.
In verse 6, you'll see the potter's power. Are not you in my hand, God said to Israel, as the clay is in the potter's hand? You're in the hand of God. You say, oh, don't tell me that. That's the same thing that Gideon said when the angel of the Lord went over and sat down by a tree and watched Gideon plowing. And he came around by where the angel was. He didn't even know he was out there. So I don't think some people even realize how often heaven may be visiting them. They don't even know that God's around.
Yeah.
Right.
And the angel said unto him, You can save all of Israel, thou mighty man of valor. And it disgusted Gideon. You know what he said? Oh, my Lord, if God be with us, he said, then why do we have all these problems? Just because you've got insurmountable problems and issues in your life and you think God's not with you, you need to stop right there and quit spewing that stuff out of your mouth. Because Proverbs chapter 6 will tell you, you snare yourself with your words.
That's right.
In your worst of circumstances, God's closer than you even know.
Yeah.
Amen.
And God convinced Gideon to rise up in the fervor that he was frustrated with, and God would use him as one man to save the whole nation. And that's what God did. And God is the potter, and he has the power because we are in his hand. I've already showed you this in verse 8 through 10, but the potter also is penitent. If God has determined to destroy Mike Hutsell, because he has said it's enough, I'm going to pluck him up and I'm going to destroy him. He ignores me. He tries to question my authority. He's rebellious. He's blasphemous. I'm going to destroy him. But all of a sudden, I humble myself to God and I start repenting. God will repent of what he intended to do to me.
Yeah.
And God will show me mercy. That's what he said in these verses 7 through 10. Or let's suppose tonight that I'm saved and I'm declaring the word of God, and God has intended purposes to bless me and do great things with me. But all of a sudden I decide I'm just going to do what I want to do and live like I want to. For over 50 years, this is what I've done most of my days, is preach the gospel. And I could stop and say, you know what? I'm 70 years old. I'm going to live a little while. God could say, I'm not going to bless him. I'm going to destroy it.
Yeah.
See, whatever you do, you better be sure you've got the will of God in it. And you better not quit anything that God has willed for your life.
Amen.
You're not where you are or in any position you're in without the sovereign hand of God helping you get where you're at. And you need to be careful lest you get exalted with your self-thinking. I've done this all on my own.
No.
No, you haven't.
Yeah.
Not only does the potter have power and he has penitence, but look at chapter 18, verse 11. This is the simplicity of God's message. Jeremiah, when you go back, you tell him the two truths. I have an incontestable authority. I have irresistible ability. I can make them over again. But here's the message that I want you to give them. I have framed evil against you, saith the Lord, and devised a device against you. Return you now, every one, from his evil way, and listen. And make your ways and your doings good.
Amen.
That's a simple message, isn't it? If I had come to this pulpit tonight and said, here's God's message for you tonight. Look into your heart and your ways of life. And you're not going to do all this tonight. Listen, I do preach, and if you want to be saved, you can be saved here tonight. Let me tell you what I'd rather you did. I'm talking to you that are saved now. I'd rather you go home and take your piece of paper and pencil and sit down and write down your old ways. You ever done that? Have you ever just sat down and wrote down what your processes of a day is like? Where you start, I'm talking about charting your eating, I'm talking about charting what you read, everything you watch on television. Chart, like a diary, every conversation you have and what it was about. Write out your ways. And then on the backside of that, write out the things that God and I have done together today. And I promise you, there ain't a person sitting in this room tonight with what you've got more of your ways going on than any of God's ways going on in your life. It doesn't mean you're not saved. It doesn't mean you're not a good person and you're well-meaning. It just means sometimes that our ways are the things that keeps us from the richest blessings we can have from God.
Yeah.
And God was sick and tired of watching Israel accept everything that come along. Every idolatrous thing that come along and compromising to get along. And that's what's going on in our nation. Churches are compromising. Schools are compromising. Families are compromising. And churches are doing the same thing. And God even tells us that we need to search our ways and we need to make our ways good. Here's what Job did. When God came to him one day, and if you read the book of Job, you'll see this very clearly. Job almost presented himself as one perfect. He really was defending himself against three guys that were supposed to be his friends. Here was a man that God had put his hand on and blessed him, and he was doing well. And one day, God destroyed everything he had. You say, God did? God allowed Satan to move against him. Are you listening to me tonight? The devil can't do anything to you that God don't let him.
That's right. Amen.
The devil cannot do anything to you that God doesn't allow. You say, can you prove that scripturally? God was meeting with the angels and Satan come into the council. And Satan accused Job before God and said, he don't have any reason to fear you. You've built a hedge about him. You've protected him so much, but you let me touch everything he has and he'll curse you to your face.
Yep.
And God let him go and let him touch all of Job's wealth, and he even let him touch Job's children. What would you do if everything you spent your whole life working for, you lost it by this Friday? And however many children you have in your family, if a tornado come through tonight and killed every one of them, and all you're left with is a backyard full of memories of graves and no money to do nothing with, would you do what Job did? Job shed his regular garments and put on sackcloth and ash. Job shaved his head and he went out to the altar where he worshiped God regularly. He sat down in the ashes from the burnt offerings that he had given. And he said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the Lord.
Amen.
And a lot of people look at Job's wife when she saw how he suffered and all the agony he was going through, and they belittle Job's wife as some kind of a terrible woman. The news is tonight that she is a godly woman and she's a holy woman. And she was not trying to get Job to turn against God. She was just saying to him, Job, curse God and die. You'd be better off dead than to suffer like this. And I would tell you something. There are sufferings in life that's worse than death.
Yeah.
Unless you're unsaved. Amen. If you're unsaved and you die, you've got an eternity full of misery ahead of you.
Amen.
And Job said to her, you speak as a foolish woman. God has the right to give to us whatever he wants, and God has the right to take it back. I had a man tell me one time I was trying to win to God, and he said to me, I'm telling you right now, if God took one of mine like he did Job's, I'd never serve him. I said, you hadn't ought to say that. And 1 month after that day, he had a two-year-old baby playing around in his yard. It had rained a lot. There was kind of a sinkhole ditch there. The baby fell in that water and drowned. And they brought him to the hospital, put him on life support. I stayed by the family day and night. He hated my guts. Every time he'd come in the room where I was at, he'd point at me and he'd say, you're my enemy. Why are you here? And his wife would speak up and say, because he's my pastor and he's praying for us. And he's staying. And I told her, Jeannie, I said, if it would be better for me to go, I said, I'll go. And so I did. And I went up in, it's called Mercy Hospital now, but I went up in St. John's Hospital in the chapel. And I sat up in there and I laid in the floor. And I just happened to step out and go get a drink of water. And when I come back, that man was laying on that marble floor. He had asked his wife, where'd the preacher go? She said, I guess he's up in the chapel. He came in and I wasn't up there. But I saw puddles of tears running from the sides of his eyes and around his face. And God told me to lay down and listen to him. And I laid at his feet. And here's what he said, and I heard his words clearly. God, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean what I said. I wish you hadn't done what you've done. And God, if you'll raise my son up, I'll serve you. Then God told me to crawl up beside him and ask him, and if I don't raise him up, what will you do? And I crawled up beside him and I said, Harry, and if God doesn't raise your son up, because before you get angry, listen, what if God can see something in little Josh's life that would be far worse for him to face? And it would be better for God to take him out and take him to heaven now. And what if God knows the only way you might ever look up and even want to come to heaven is if he takes something you love and put it there so you'd have more reason to go to heaven? If God don't raise him up, what will you do? And he got up and he said, I'll never serve him. The doctors finally come out and said the baby's never been alive. He's been on life support now for 72 hours. Time to pull him off. Said he won't, there'll never be a heartbeat once we pull him off. And said there's no use in prolonging the agony. And this doctor said this, he's already with Jesus. Those are good words, folks. But I'm going to tell you, when you're sitting beside a dying baby, those words don't mean much to you. Are you listening to me? I know you are. And so Harry told his wife, I can't pull the plug. She said, I can. And they did. And Josh didn't live. Harry changed his attitude toward me. He came and asked me if I'd preach the funeral. And I said, I would. And Preacher Chang, here's what he did. When they're passing by the last time, he reached in the casket and he gathered that little boy up in his arms. He said, oh, Josh. Son, I'm going to take you home now. And I'm going to try to change what I said. Because you wouldn't be where you're at if I hadn't been foolish. And the funeral director came over and said, Harry, you can't take him home. Feel his body. He's embalmed. He's hard as a rock. He's gone. There's no life there. He's with the Lord. Didn't you hear the preacher? He said, no, all I hear is what I said. Listen to me. I just learned here recently that he died. Harry died. And he died a drunk. And he died mad at God. But I want to tell you what he did the second after he died and saw God. From then until now, even as I'm preaching, living in this second, in this hour that we're living in, Harry's telling God over and over again, I'm so sorry. I wish God I'd have never said what I said.
Yeah.
You might not be saved and you might not be living right and you may be hard. I don't know what your life is, but be careful what you say.
That's right.
Be careful with what spirit you have when you say it. Listen, if you're angry, and don't kid yourself, God knows when we're mad at Him. You haven't fooled God. You say, what does God think about that? God is far bigger than you and I. He can look beyond our petty little angers. But if you're mad at God and you're not willing to humble yourself to Him and repent, the best thing you can do is go sit alone and be quiet until your heart gets past its heated anger. And then in some sound mind and wisdom say, if you're really God, then you help me see where I'm in error and help me find truth. Because, folks, I want you to know tonight, God is truth.
Yeah.
And tonight, as they come to get us a song ready, the message that was in the potter's house is simple. By divine direction, Jeremiah was sent to see the work that was being wrought on the wheel. When he got there and saw the work and saw it marred in the potter's hands, he realized that there was defilement in that clay. And God said, could I not do the same thing with Israel? Because there was defilement in Israel. There was sin there. You're the clay in my hands, God told Israel. And the reason I told you tonight, change that from old house of Israel to old house of Little Sack Baptist Church. Every one of us in this tent tonight, we're the clay in God's hands.
Yeah.
He's the potter. And God said, cannot I do what the potter did with that clay? Instead of wiping it off the wheel and destroying it, I can make it another vessel. A vessel of honor and a vessel of glory. Yeah. If you don't believe that, read the 9th chapter of Romans when you get home tonight. God told Pharaoh, because you hardened your heart, I used you to show my power to Israel. And God said, I can make vessels of honor out of one piece of clay, and I can make vessels of dishonor out of another. And the thing you don't want God to ever have to do is make you a vessel of dishonor or use you as an example to help others. I'll tell you what I do know about Harry's little boy. There was a lot of folks that come to Jesus and got saved as a result of what they observed from that funeral. And let me tell you something, it had nothing to do with the sermon I preached. It had nothing to do with me, period. It had everything to do with what they seen the hand of God do. And they knew God was merciful and would have saved that man if he'd allowed him. But he chose not to. So God said to Israel, here's what I want you to do. I want you to make your ways and your doings right. Now, if you know you've got some ways and some doings that need to stop and you need to repent, I invite you to come and talk to God. You don't need to talk to me or anyone else. You need to talk to God. And if you don't know you've got any, and you go from this tabernacle and you don't evaluate yourself from this message by sitting down and thinking through your ways and your doings, and if you find some ways and some doings wherever you're at, you don't have to be in the house of God. Kneel right where you're at and fix what's wrong with God. Stand with me while we pray. Father, I pray that you'll examine every heart and every soul. And I pray, God, tonight that if there's anyone in this house that does not have right ways and right doings in your sight that you're not pleased with, and there's anything, God, that they need to be at this altar discussing with you, I pray they'll come. If there's someone here that's never been saved, they've never asked Jesus to come into their heart, they've never repented of their sins, let this be the night that they come and say, Jesus, save me. I want you to be my Lord. And Father, tonight you'll save them because that's your promise. Bless now, God, in this invitation as the Villines family sings for us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Won't you come as God speaks and directs your heart?
In the middle of the night, I'm praying for assurance, everything's gonna be alright. Lord, I see another light out in front of me. I'm afraid I won't be able, and I'll go down.
Bye.
man suffering pain when it looked like the wicked would go free. And in my frustration, that just didn't seem right to me. I asked you for sunshine, you sent the rain. I cried for healing, but only got pain. And I know your love will see me through, Lord.
Someone else up above theirs or something of that nature, but that's never my intention. I want everybody to understand that, but Mikey, you and your buddy step out here real quick. All week long, Mike has been trying to get his buddy from church camp to come to tent revival with him. I think that's an admirable thing for a boy his age to want his friend to come to a tent meeting with him.
Amen.
I love all of our kids. They're all great kids. I'm not trying to say Mikey's the best kid. I just, this is what's happened this week watching him. Will your parents bring it? Can you guys come? We'd love to have you. There ain't a lot of kids his age doing that today in the world.
That's right.
And I know all these kids are always trying to get someone to come along or do something or show them to Jesus, and I wanted you all to see that it's working. What we're trying to do and instill in these kids, the Lord bless them.
Amen.
It's having an effect and it's changing them, and that means the world to me as a pastor.
Amen.
I love all the adults, but y'all are old enough to know better sometimes. It's these young ones I worry about. Amen. I'm just thankful for that. So, Mikey, keep fighting a good fight of faith. Glad to have you here tonight, young man. Your parents came with you. I'll get to meet them and introduce myself. But I'm thankful to see youngins that want people to come worship the Lord with them. That's amazing to me. There's so many other things a 15-year-old could be wanting to do, and he wants his buddies to come to tent meeting with him. That's awesome to me. Church, say amen.
Amen. Amen.
That is awesome tonight. So I'm thankful for the word tonight, Brother Mike. As always, it was a blessing and it was an encouragement.
Amen.
I said earlier, I love good shouting, stomping, snorting, slobber slinging preaching. And Brother Mike Hutsell is the only one I know that'll do that and teach you something real deep in the Word of God at the same time.
Right.
Only one other man that'll do that. And it's always been an amazement to me. And I'm just thankful for all that him and Sister Brenda are doing in Africa as well. It was good to hear a report like that and see how the food deal took off like that. That's a blessing. So we're going to continue love offering. Brother Mike, Brother Dwayne, if you'll make your way forward. This is the last night we get to be with Brother Mike and the Villines Trio. So if you can, I don't pay attention to money. I got my bouncers up here that do that. I'm sure you've already been trying to bless them. But if you can,